Hello and welcome to Newsclick. You all would have seen by now that BJP is leading in both Gujarat and Himachal Pradesh. Let's look at the figures. BJP is leading at almost 105 seats in Gujarat, while Congress is at 71 seats. Others are having lead on 6 seats. Congress is somewhere around 41% vote share and BJP somewhere around 49% vote share. Now let's look at the 2012 results. BJP had 115 seats in 2012, while Congress had 61 seats. After defection, BJP had somewhere around 122 seats in Gujarat, as most of the Congress MLAs had shifted to BJP. Let's look at Himachal Pradesh now. Congress was in government in Himachal Pradesh with 36 seats in 2012, and 26 seats were to BJP. In 2017, the trends have reversed. 42 seats have gone to BJP, they are leading on 42 seats, while Congress is on 22 seats. Left has made its entry in Himachal Pradesh Assembly with 1 seat, others on 3. The vote share is somewhere similar, which is 48% for BJP and 41% for Congress. Now if we look at the election campaign that was followed in Gujarat, it showed clear desperation for BJP. Modi was all talking about Pakistan, was abusing his opponents, and was talking about the issues of nationalism. The issues of the people were missing from the campaign. And results are visible that there is no Modi wave in Gujarat. BJP is losing its ground while Congress has gained. And in a way, it's an honorable defeat for Congress, which has revived. If we look at Himachal Pradesh, Congress is clearly facing anti-incumbency, while BJP is gaining grounds. The early trends show that even the CM candidate was trailing, now he's leading. When it comes to Gujarat, Jignesh Mevani, an independent candidate, is leading by a huge margin, and I think he would have won by now. To discuss these elections, we are joined by Tari Kanwar, senior journalist of Newsclick, who has covered extensively the Gujarat elections, and Tikender Singh Power, former deputy mayor of Shimla and a member of CPIM. So welcome to Newsclick, both of you.
Thank you.
To start with Gujarat, Jignesh Mevani is winning. BJP had shown massive sign of desperation. People's issues were completely missing. Communism was their only agenda. And still, they have not been able to gain the target that they had set. What do you have to say about it?
First of all, Pranjal, Jignesh has already registered victory. He won by a huge margin of more than 18,000 votes. And second thing, you are right in saying that people's issue took backbench in the entire election campaign in Gujarat. We broke the story initially there was a campaign going on in the name of Haj versus Ram.
Ram, right.
Haj stands for Hardik, Alpesh and Jignesh. And Ram was Rupani, Amit Shah and Modi. So people were given a poster, whom do you want to vote to favor, either Haj or Ram. So and in the last phase of the election campaigning, we saw the entire political discourse changed.
So it actually looked like that communism was the only last resort that BJP had, and this is the only agenda that they are going to follow.
Exactly. In the last phase of election campaigning there, Modi brought the issue of Pakistan and every non-issue, who said what Manish Shankar Iyer said and what Renuka Chaudhary said, and all political rhetoric. There was no words on development, demonetization, GST. And you can say that the BJP tried to play on people's emotion. Modi tried himself to connect with the Gujarati Asmita, which I guess to a large extent has worked in favor of the BJP, which is leading in most of the seats, not most of the seats, which is in position to form the government there.
So actually, if you look at the economy of Gujarat, It looked like due to demonetization and GST, the rural economy and also the traders community was most hit.
Yes.
So what do you mean, what role did that play?
अगर हम एनालाइज करें रूरल वोट्स की, कांग्रेस ने बहुत अच्छा इनरोड किया है वहाँ पे. जब हम रूरल सौराष्ट्र के रूरल एरियाज़ में गए, इवन नॉर्थ और साउथ गुजरात के रूरल एरियाज़ में गए, जहाँ पे फार्मिंग कम्युनिटी रह रही है, वहाँ पे वहाँ की मेन कैश क्रॉप कॉटन है और मूंगफली है. पीपल वर कंप्लेनिंग अबाउट लोअर रेट ऑफ देयर एग्रीकल्चरल प्रोड्यूस. वो 700-800 रुपए का बता रहे थे, 700-800 रुपीस दे आर गेटिंग फॉर 20 kg ऑफ कॉटन, विच इज मच लोअर देन व्हाट दे स्पेंड ऑन फॉर प्रोडक्शन. तो ये गुस्सा बहुत बहुत विजिबल था और ये कांग्रेस के फेवर में गया है. लेकिन कांग्रेस की ये पोजीशन, हालांकि कांग्रेस अभी अच्छी पोजीशन में है, एक एग्रेसिव अपोजिशन मिलेगा गुजरात असेंबली को, उस तरह की गवर्नमेंट नहीं रहेगी जो पिछले 22 साल से गवर्नमेंट गुजरात ने देखा है. लेकिन कांग्रेस से जो गलतियां हुई, मुझे ये लगता है कि कांग्रेस फेल टू कंसोलिडेट द एंगर ऑन द ग्राउंड कंप्लीटली. दे फेल टू, आप उसको कह सकते हैं कि वो जो वोटर्स थे उनको वो बूथ तक नहीं ला पाए, और ये उनका सबसे बड़ा फेल्योर रहा.
तो ये जो संगठन की कमी है, क्योंकि भाजपा के पास तो राष्ट्रीय स्वयंसेवक संघ का संगठन है जो लगातार घरों में जाके लगातार कैंपेन कर रहे हैं, और ये पूरे कैंपेन में भी बहुत अच्छे से विजिबल था कि एक तरफ रूपानी जी बोल रहे हैं कि अगर भाजपा हार गई गुजरात में तो पाकिस्तान में पटाखे फोड़े जाएंगे, तो ये तो सीधा सीधा RSS की भाषा है. कांग्रेस के संगठन में क्या कमी थी?
कांग्रेस के संगठन में कमी क्या कहें हम, कांग्रेस का कोई संगठन अगर ऐसे एनालाइज किया जाए तो कांग्रेस का कोई संगठन नहीं है गुजरात में. इनफैक्ट दूसरे स्टेट्स में भी यही देखने को मिलता है कि कांग्रेस का कोई संगठन नहीं, एक कमिटमेंट होता है, एक वर्कर्स कमिटमेंट होता है टुवर्ड्स पार्टी, विच वॉज एबसेंट कम्प्लीटली. और दूसरी तरफ ये कि जब सेकेंड फेज की पोलिंग हो रही थी, मोस्ट ऑफ द कांग्रेस लीडर्स आई स्पोक टू वर स्लीपिंग ऑन द पोलिंग डे. तो एक जनरली एक ये ट्रेंड देखा गया है कि अगर किसी इलेक्शन में वोटर टर्नआउट ज़्यादा है तो उसको इस तरह से एनालाइज करते हैं कि एंटी इनकम्बेंसी के अगेंस्ट वोट हो रहा है. लेकिन यहाँ पे सिचुएशन वो नहीं थी, यहाँ पर वोटर टर्नआउट कम रहा और बीजेपी ने अपनी पूरी कोशिश की वहाँ पे, बीजेपी के जो कमिटेड वोटर्स थे उनको वो पोलिंग बूथ पे लाए, पोल कराया, और आज ये रिजल्ट देखने को मिल रहा है. कांग्रेस यहाँ पे फेल होती हुई, हालांकि उन्होंने बहुत अच्छी कैंपेनिंग की, बहुत एग्रेसिव कैंपेन किया और वेव उनके फेवर में था, लेकिन वो उसको वोट में नहीं कन्वर्ट करा पाए. दिस इज व्हाट आई फील सीइंग द एंटायर ट्रेंड सो फार.
गुजरात में पिछले एक साल से लगातार कई मूवमेंट्स भी हमने देखे हैं. युवाओं का मूवमेंट रहा है, जिग्नेश की बात है, अल्पेश की बात हो या हार्दिक की बात हो, जिग्नेश चुनाव भी जीत गए हैं. इन युवाओं का, पाटीदार, OBC, दलित, इनका क्या रोल रहा इस पूरे इलेक्शन में? क्योंकि अगर ये एक कंसोलिडेटेड वोट भी होता तो शायद कांग्रेस इतनी बुरी तरीके से, परफॉर्मेंस अच्छा है पर शायद वो सरकार बना रहे होते.
अगर हम पाटीदार डोमिनेटेड जो 20-22 सीट्स हैं उनको देखें, तो हर जो मेहसाना, जो जहां से पाटीदार एजिटेशन की शुरुआत हुई थी, वहां पे देखें तो वडनगर की वो उंझा कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी है जिसमें उंझा कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी में वडनगर आता है. वडनगर PM मोदी का होम ग्राउंड, वहां पे PM मोदी पैदा हुए थे, तो वडनगर उनकी कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी मानी जाती है. हालांकि वो मेहसाना डिस्ट्रिक्ट में है, लेकिन डिलिमिटेशन 2008 के डिलिमिटेशन के बाद वडनगर उंझा कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी में आ गए. उंझा में BJP हार गई. एक सीट को छोड़ के जो मेहसाना की 7 सीट्स हैं वो सब, उसमें कांग्रेस एक या दो को छोड़ के कांग्रेस लीड कर रही है. तो पाटीदार एजिटेशन का फायदा मिला है कांग्रेस को. एक नई चीज जो देखने को मिली है, जिसको डिस्क्रेडिट कर रही थी BJP और जो हमारे एनालिस्ट हैं वो डिस्क्रेडिट कर रहे थे, ये जो 3 नए चेहरे उभर के आए, इन्होंने अपने आप को एज ए लीडर एस्टैब्लिश किया. अल्पेश इज लीडिंग, जिग्नेश हैज वन, हार्दिक का बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट रोल रहा है इसमें, और हर पाटीदार पॉकेट्स में हम देखें तो कांग्रेस वहाँ पे लीड कर रही है। कांग्रेस का फेल्योर रहा जो बीजेपी की स्ट्रेटजी थी उसमें बहुत हद तक बीजेपी कामयाब होती हुई दिख रही है। बीजेपी की लास्ट मिनट जो स्ट्रेटजी थी कि ओबीसी जो वोटर्स थे, जब ये पाटीदार को के एंगर को सबसाइड नहीं कर पाए तो इन्होंने शिफ्ट किया अपनी स्ट्रेटजी को और इन्होंने काम करना शुरू किया ओबीसी वोटर्स से, ये कहते हुए कि जब पाटीदार को कांग्रेस पावर में आती है और पाटीदार को एजिटेशन दिया जाए को जो रिजर्वेशन दिया जाएगा वो रिजर्वेशन आपका जो शेयर है उससे काट के दिया जाएगा। इसमें भी बीजेपी बहुत कामयाब नहीं हो पाई, तो उनका जो लास्ट रिसोर्ट था वो ट्राइबल वोट बैंक था जिसको उन्होंने कंसोलिडेट किया अपने फेवर में, और इसीलिए हम देख सकते हैं कि हर ट्राइबल बेल्ट में बीजेपी लीड कर रही है।
जिग्नेश के मुद्दे पे हम दोबारा आपके पास वापस आएंगे। टिकेंदर, सो कांग्रेचुलेशंस फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल फॉर गेनिंग वन सीट इन हिमाचल प्रदेश एंड लेफ्ट हैज मेड इट्स एंट्री इनटू द असेंबली। हाउ डू यू सी दैट विक्ट्री? व्हाट इंपैक्ट विल इट हैव?
How do I see that victory is actually when we coined the slogan in Himachal, what is the agenda that we're going to take to the people? So our slogan was of a real opposition, because what we emphatically campaigned in the elections was that both BJP and Congress happens to be two sides of the same coin. I mean, they don't represent an opposition at all. And actually, if you see by last 15 or 20 years, what they've been doing in the assembly is not on people's issues, the debate, but how to increase their wages, salaries. That really clicked. I mean, so the real role of the opposition, how that role of the opposition has to be played, we gave that slogan. So the CPM is not going to form a government because we were contesting some 20 seats. And the CPM also doesn't want a situation whereby it is because of CPM that a government gets formed. So our slogan was very concrete that we want a representation and someone who actually represents the voice of the opposition, the way Modi is trying to decimate the entire opposition in the country. Right. So that really clicked in the minds. And how do I see that? I think the candidate who's won, Rakesh Singha, also has earlier represented the Shimla urban constituency. So there are lots of hope and lots of aspiration amongst the people that at least someone will be representing the issues of the people. For example, the course, if you just understand how the state of Himachal has developed, probably it's one of the best left of center development that has taken place after Kerala, though it was Congress for a long time that played that role, right from 1970s to 1990s. But yes, then after 1990s, what we call the post neoliberal era. And that also speaks about why no party has been able to win after the 1990s. Every 5 years, people just remove them off. So that speaks about the real issues of development. And why the development could take place from 1970s to 90s, and post 1990s, why the governments were incapacitated to perform. And it was also part of the structural adjustment that took place from the center, and that has really affected important sectors like health, education. And so who will champion those issues? Who will champion those causes? For example, health is becoming one of the largest agendas to intervene. Similarly, education, because we have even in the remotest place, you'll find the schools. So we have the hardware, but the software slowly got missing. Like you have an ambulance in the village, but you won't have a driver to drive that ambulance. So I think those aspirations, and land has of late become a very pivotal issue. For example, in Himachal, 70% of the land is owned by the forest. I don't want to go into those details. And so the land that people own, the Forest Tribal Act has hardly been implemented. So people own that land and they've been owning it for decades together. But all of a sudden, the government terms them as encroachers. So we really fought that movement. And it is in this region of Shimla where we have been able to win. So how do I see is, I think, a real opposition coming up, maybe just because of one, and there are a few independents also coming up.
It also looks like that the left is emerging as the third major force in Himachal Pradesh.
Yeah, I can say the left has always been that. Probably the left owns that responsibility. Because we have a very strong students movement and it's pan-Himachal. So every nook and corner of the state, you'll find some presence of the left. Unlike, and fortunately, we don't have any third party third party of any sort in Himachal. So that space can be and slowly is being utilized by the left.
Let's come back to the results.
Yeah.
So is it merely anti-incumbency against the Congress, or BJP was properly able to take its agenda to the people?
You see, if you understand how BJP was able to, they did it very smartly, by the way, the BJP, because initially they brought the Modi narrative to the fore, and then they realized, hey, Modi narrative is going to get defeated. Can you believe the party that said, no, we will never declare a chief ministerial candidate, all of a sudden in between said no, because they realized Modi is going to be defeated. So this Modi narrative of development, because there is a Himachal narrative of development, and the kind of narrative that they were trying to build, the Modi narrative of development, was not clicking at all. I mean, people said, we don't want that Modi narrative of development, especially after demonetization, after GST, the way the business community was responding. So they were very clever that they brought a chief ministerial candidate in the form of Dhumal, who is a statesman undoubtedly, and who is also representing a large community of the Rajputs. So they were in a fix that they will target. They will keep that ambiguity, and slowly they'll that's how they do it for the way they did it in Uttar Pradesh or Uttarakhand or Haryana. So they couldn't do that because they realized that Modi narrative is not going to work. So it's the people's narrative, and let us focus not on the pan-Indian issues, but only on the issues of anti-incumbency of Congress. So, and they were able to.
So what do you think, what impact will it have, BJP coming back to power in Himachal Pradesh?
Impact in Himachal or all India?
Himachal.
BJP is not seen a very pro-Himachal party. Because when Himachal was formed, we didn't have BJP at that time, but it was Jan Sangh. And Jan Sangh used to coin slogans like stay at hold, maro thod, very good. They never wanted Himachal to be carved out of
right.
Punjab.
Right.
So, they are considered to be more anti-Himachal stuff. And I don't know how they will really frame their entire discourse now, and how would they decide to govern the state. But going by the logic, we have a debt of 40,000 crores, and we have a neoliberal framework in which the parties work. Because, for example, Congress tried to intervene and was even able to put it in the manifesto that no outsourcing will take place. So probably the impact would be this would enhance that pace, enhancement of more outsourcing, because Himachal is probably one of the states where we have the largest per capita human resource engagement in government services, largest per capita, nowhere in the country, not even Kerala for that matter, any other state. So that is going to, I think, be hit more, which means it will affect the common people more, in the sense it will affect the services of health, education, because it will amount to more outsourcing, more privatization. And of course, the previous BJP government was considered to be a land mafia.
Yeah.
So I don't know how they will reincarnate. How they will reincarnate themselves and what kind of metamorphosis will take place, you never know. But yes, that is how they have been branded. But never have they been like pro-state, you see, that pro-Himachal kind of stuff. So I think it will be a challenge. But for the left, it will be a golden opportunity, because given the reality that if it is BJP, the left bring more cadres to the streets. And if you have an elected representative, I think there couldn't have been a better opportunity than what is now.
Tariq, this would be my last question. Gujarat mein BJP phir se wapas aa rahi hai. पर साथ ही साथ जिग्नेश मेवानी जैसे इंडिपेंडेंट कैंडिडेट एक बड़े मार्जिन के साथ विधानसभा में जा रहे हैं, इसका इम्पैक्ट गुजरात के पॉलिटिक्स पे क्या पड़ेगा?
इसका इम्पैक्ट अगर पॉजिटिवली देखें, ये तो ऐसा कहा जा सकता है ये कि गुजरातीज अब जो कांग्रेस वर्सेस बीजेपी की जो बाइपोलर पॉलिटिक्स है उससे आगे निकलना चाह रही है. नॉट ओनली जिग्नेश, आप देखें कांग्रेस इसको चेक करना शायद नहीं कर पाई चेक, कि कांग्रेस बहुत सारी सीट जहां पे वो ट्रेल कर रही है. आप देखेंगे कि थर्ड या सेकंड जो कैंडिडेट है वो इंडिपेंडेंट कैंडिडेट है और बहुत हाई नंबर ऑफ वोट्स लाए, वो बहुत सारी कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंसी पे दे आर गेटिंग मोर देन 20,000 वोट्स. ये भी एक स्ट्रेटेजी थी, स्पेशली ये आपको पाटीदार सीट्स के उस पर ट्रेंड पे मिलेगा कि पाटीदार सीट्स पे जहाँ पे कांग्रेस ट्रेल कर रही है वहाँ पे इंडिपेंडेंट कैंडिडेट बहुत बड़े नंबर में वोट गेन कर रहे हैं. तो ये एक कांग्रेस को कॉर्नर करने की एक और स्ट्रैटेजी थी, कांग्रेस इसको चेक नहीं कर पाई और उनको इतना वोट मिलना ये बात साबित करता है कि जो गुजरात के लोग हैं वहाँ के इलेक्टोरेट, ये जो बाइपोलर पॉलिटिक्स है इससे आगे निकल के एक नया अल्टरनेटिव के रूप में कैंडिडेट्स को लाना चाह रहे हैं. और ये एक चैलेंज है गवर्नमेंट के लिए कि सी दिस इज वन ऑफ द ऑप्शंस, सो बीवर.
थैंक्स अ लॉट फॉर गिविंग अस योर टाइम. As we have seen and as both of our panelists have told that there is no Modi wave either in Gujarat or in Himachal Pradesh. Even in Himachal Pradesh, they had to declare a CM candidate because Modi didn't want to appear as a losing candidate. As we see, communism is the last resort that BJP has. That is what it followed in Himachal Pradesh. That is what it followed in Gujarat. Let's see what happens. The final results are yet not out. We'll be coming back to you with the final results at 5 o'clock. Keep following our Facebook page for more updates. Thank you.